Flying the Boeing 747 or a Boeing 747 flight simulator becomes a lot easier when you understand when and why to use the buttons on the flight deck. The most used panel is called the MCP, the Mode Control Panel, and I'm going to explain how that works coming up. Hey 7-4 crew, what's going on? If you don't know me, my name's Kelsey. I'm a 747 pilot. My channel, 7-4 Gear, is all about aviation. So whether you're a pilot or an aviation enthusiast, consider subscribing. The MCP is the panel you're going to want to get very familiar with. Whether you're flying any Boeing aircraft, they're all relatively similar, but today I'm covering specifically the Boeing 747 MCP. In this video, I'm going to break down what each of the buttons do and when I use them. Let's get into it. There's an art to flying, and Boeing allows its pilots a little bit more control over how they want to accomplish their end goal. So in some cases, you'll see multiple buttons that do very similar or the same things. In this video, I'm going to tell you how I go about each of the different ones. If you end up becoming a Boeing pilot, you're going to spend hours, if not days, covering this one specific panel. It is going to be something you're going to use all the time when you're out flying. Now, I don't have hours or days to cover it on this YouTube channel or everybody would unsubscribe, but I'm going to cover the buttons and when I use them to accomplish the goals that I want when I'm flying. Flight Director. This is a switch you're going to flip as one of the early pre-flight things that you do as you're getting in your plane and getting everything settled. And when you hit that Flight Director switch on your primary flight display, you will see this. And there's one for each side, so the captain and the first officer are both going to have that switch. And you're gonna hit that as one of your primary things that you do once you get settled into the plane. Autothrottle Arm. That is a switch that's gonna be flipped when you're getting ready for takeoff. There's not a lot to explain about it. An autothrottle is an autothrottle, and that switch is when you turn it on, and you don't turn it on usually until right before takeoff. The thrust switch. The thrust button we call Dusty Thrusty, and that's because it's not something that's commonly used. The only time that I've ever used that is in a flight simulator, in training, when we have an engine failure and we need to clean up the plane and we decide not to clean it up all the way, you'll use that thrust button. But for 99% of the time, for 99% of you that are watching, it's not something you really need to worry about, but that is what the thrust button is. The speed button is another button that is used, but I rarely use it that way by hitting that button. But that speed button will open up the speed window. But there's a more efficient way to get that window opened up, which I'll cover a little bit later. The IAS / mock selector is what I use usually when I open up the speed window. Earlier I was saying I don't use that speed button, and that is because if you hit the selector, you will open up that speed window. And from there, you're able to then dial in what speed. So you might have a scenario where air traffic control says to you, hey, we want you to maintain 280 knots. What you'll do is you'll hit that button, it will open up the speed window, and since your hand is already there, you dial in 280 knots, and now it's the most efficient way in order to get that speed. The alternative would be hit the speed button, then bring your hand over to the selector, and then dial it in. So this is just a more efficient way to get that done. Hey crew, there are two parts of this video when I originally recorded that didn't get recorded correctly. So this one, and there's one later on, that are gonna be interjected in the video just so everything is complete. The IAS / mock select button is used when the speed window is open and you wanna switch from indicated airspeed to the mock number. LNAV. LNAV is the lateral navigation of the aircraft. The easiest way I can explain it to you is if you gave your car a route that you needed it to drive and you programmed it into the computer and then you hopped in, it would follow that road. That essentially is what the LNAV is doing. It's keeping you along your course that you programmed into the computer, and it's telling you left or right how to get there. VNAV is your vertical navigation. Now your LNAV doesn't care about you going up or down, just like your VNAV doesn't care about you going left or right on your course. So your VNAV is going to control the path going vertically, up or descending, and your LNAV is going to control your left or right of your course. As an example, if you were to have LNAV and VNAV engaged on a ball that you were throwing to your friend, what that means is every time you threw the ball, it would go in the exact same lateral path and the exact same vertical path that it was going to reach to your friend's glove or to his hand. So that LNAV-VNAV is a very precise way to get from one point to another point. The Fletch button, or the Flight Level Change button, is used in a few different scenarios. One very common scenario that you would need this button is if you were engaged in VNAV and climbing up and then you had to descend, you would use that Flight Level Change button to get it to go down again. Another scenario that you might use Flight Level Change is if you're not on a VNAV path, let's say you were flying at 6,000 feet and you wanted to descend to 5,000 feet, you could select 5,000 feet in your altitude window, hit Flight Level Change, and the plane would descend to 5,000 feet. There are a lot of different scenarios which you're going to use these buttons, but those are two scenarios which you could use Flight Level Change. Even though the name Flight Level Change indicates that you're at the flight levels, you can use that Flight Level Change button at any altitude. All right, back to the regular video now. So in using the example of the ball that you're throwing to your friend, let's say you threw that ball to your friend, and while that ball is going up in the air, you decide, no, I want it to come down earlier than I had programmed in the box. What you would do is use that Flight Level Change button. And what that's going to do is now the plane is going to be, while it's climbing up, let's say you have it set to go to 10,000 feet. And while it's at 8,000 feet, you decide, no, I want it to come down to 5,000 feet. You would spin the altitude selector down to 5,000 feet and hit the Flight Level Change button. And that's going to disengage it from the VNAV and have it start coming down again. So if you were throwing the ball to your friend and you, while it was going up, decide, no, I want it to go to a friend of ours that's in between both of us, you would use that Flight Level Change button to get it to come down. Now, the heading selector is used to fly on a specific heading, kind of like what it sounds like. What you'll see is when pilots are flying on a Boeing product, that heading does not automatically sync to the direction that you're flying. So you'll hear pilots say, heading to course. So as an example, if I'm the pilot monitoring, and the other pilot, the captain, is flying, and the plane turns to the left, that's engaged on LNAV, it automatically turns to the left because that's the route that's programmed in there, that heading selector will not automatically move to that direction. So you'll hear a pilot say, heading to course. That's my way to tell the captain, your heading selector is not matching the course that we're flying on. So that heading selector is not automatically going to be matching the direction that you're going. It's important that you keep that on the course that you're going for a few different reasons. But one of the scenarios could be, ATC could say, maintain your current heading. At which point, all you have to do is hit that heading select button, and now LNAV is disengaged and heading is engaged. Now the autopilot is going to fly that specific heading because you've pushed the button, LNAV is disengaged, heading select is now engaged, and will start flying that specific course. More often, you'll start using that as you're getting closer to arrivals or departures when air traffic control wants you to fly a specific heading to intercept to come into land, or on departure, they want you to fly a heading to get onto your course. That heading selector is used to hold a specific heading. The bank angle is a selector that you can pick when you're in heading mode only, and it will allow you to limit the angle of bank that you'll have while you're in a specific heading. It's not something that you'll commonly see pilots using while they're out flying, but that is what that means. And now, similar to the speed button, there's this heading button. If you hit the heading select knob, you'll be able to engage heading mode, just like I talked about with the speed button. If you hit that speed selector, it will open up that speed window. The same for the heading. So usually, if I'm asked to hold a heading, I'll hit this heading selector instead of the heading button. If you're in a climb or descent, air traffic control may ask you for a vertical speed of 1500 feet or better. In that scenario, you're gonna wanna hit the vertical speed button and roll the knob until it's showing 1500 feet in that window. And you can move it up or down by 100 feet as necessary. Now, this is a less common way to get vertical navigation because you lose some protection with it. However, in a scenario that you need to reduce your rate of climb or your rate of descent, you will use that. So some pilots don't like to use it, but as long as you understand the logic behind what the computer is doing, it's very easy. The altitude window is pretty self-explanatory. It is basically telling the aircraft, this is the altitude that you're authorized to climb or descend to. So you're gonna use this selector and choose an altitude. Again, it's by hundreds of feet that you're able to pick this altitude. Now the button below that says hold. That's an altitude hold button. A scenario that you're gonna use the altitude hold button would be something like this. Let's say you've programmed the aircraft to go to 10,000 feet. And as you're climbing through 8,000 feet, air traffic control says, stop your climb. In that scenario, it's gonna be faster for you to hit the hold button, and that will tell the computer, hey, stop at this altitude. Obviously, it's gonna be in a climb, so it might go up and then come back down, but that's going to be a lot faster than dialing in 8,000 and trying to hit the flight level change button to get back to that altitude. So that hold button tells the computer, stop here. So that's when you're going to want to use your altitude hold button, is if it's going, climbing, or descending, and you want it to stop what it's doing at that specific altitude. Your loc button is your localizer button. So if you're coming onto an approach, air traffic control may say something like, intercept the localizer, which means you are not cleared for the actual ILS or the approach, but they just want you to intercept the course that you're going to be lining up onto the runway with. So that localizer is what you'd arm in that scenario, localizer. Or if you're doing a localizer approach, you would arm the localizer. The reason you wouldn't arm the button below that, which says approach, is that the logic the computer would tell you, once you hit your glide slope, the plane would start descending and you haven't been authorized to descend. So as you come in and you get told intercept the localizer, you'll arm the localizer button. Once you get told you were cleared for the approach, you'd hit the button below that, the approach button. That approach button is what's going to allow you to come down on the glide slope if you're doing an ILS. The command button arms the autopilot. Generally, the captain will use the left autopilot, the first officer will use the right autopilot, and the middle autopilot, kind of like a middle child, gets ignored. But it is used if one of the two other autopilots aren't functioning. It is used then, and there are a few other times when it's used in flight for auto lands or things like that. But generally speaking, the captain will use the left and the first officer will use the right side. So I'm sorry, middle children, but it's just not a commonly used button. The disengage bar is a way to disengage the autopilot. There's a bunch of different ways to do it, but that's the one on the MCP that allows you to quickly disengage the autopilot. If it's not doing what it is that you want it to be doing, you just want to turn it off. I remember a time early in my aviation career when I was flying regional jets and the autopilot wasn't doing what I wanted it to do. Now, I didn't understand why, because I was very new on the aircraft. It was my first week actually flying it. But the captain said, if it's not doing what it is that you want it to do, stop staring at it, disconnect it, and fly the plane. So that's one way to disconnect it. There's one on the yoke as well, and there's a few other ways to disconnect the autopilot. But on the MCP, that bar is a way to disconnect the autopilot. Now, something that's very important with Boeing aircraft is whatever you're doing on that MCP, you want to look at your primary flight display and make sure that the thing you have selected is actually showing on that primary flight display. You may have thought you hit heading select, but heading select did not show up on your primary flight display. And that's your flight mode annunciator. That set of three bars along the top there is going to tell you what mode of flight your aircraft is in. So it's important that whatever you select, that you look there and verify. If you selected a new altitude, you want to look at it. If you've selected a new heading, instead of being an LNAV, you want to look and verify it there. That is going to tell you what the plane is actually doing. So in some cases, you may have thought you hit the button, but the button didn't actually get hit, and therefore the plane is not going to do what you want or you thought it was about to do. So it's important when you hit that button that you look at your primary flight display and see that it is doing what it is that you thought you selected. All right, crew, that's everything they have on the Boeing 747 MCP. In the comment section below, let me know, are you watching this video because you're planning on being a Boeing pilot, or are you planning on using this for your flight simulator? I look forward to hearing from you. Until then, keep the blue side up.